Biology is the study of life, and life is made up of molecules. Molecules obey the laws of chemistry. Only with the basics of chemistry can we understand the fascinating ways in which molecules, cells, and organisms work. Here, we'll review fundamental and really important chemical principles to lay the foundation for biology. All matter is made up of atoms. An atom is the fundamental unit of an element. Take charcoal, for example, which is made of carbon. Here's what an atom of carbon looks like. You can't break an atom of carbon apart and still have something characteristic of carbon. There are three fundamental particles that make up an atom: protons, neutrons, and electrons. Protons each carry a positive one charge, neutrons are neutral, no charge, and electrons each carry a minus one charge. The structure of an atom is a core called the nucleus, shown here in red, which is made of protons and neutrons, and a cloud of electrons surrounding that nucleus. The electron cloud is organized into shells. The first electron shell is closest to the nucleus and can hold two electrons. The rest of the electron shells that we'll be looking at can each hold eight electrons. Shells are filled starting with the first shell, closest to the nucleus, and the first electron shell has to be filled before adding electrons to the next electron shell. Each additional electron shell is farther from the nucleus. Take a look at the periodic table. Each element is determined by its number of protons, starting with hydrogen and reading the table like a page. Hydrogen has one proton, helium has two, lithium has three, and so on. The number of protons in an element is called the atomic number, and it's shown here on the periodic table. Every element has a unique number of protons. Copper, for example, has a different number of protons and thus a different atomic number than does oxygen. So how many protons does carbon have? Six, and you can either find that by counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or by looking at its atomic number, which is here. Both protons and neutrons contribute to the mass of an atom. The atomic mass is about equal to the number of protons plus the number of neutrons, because electrons weigh almost nothing, and this is listed on the periodic table here. It's hard to see on this periodic table, but the atomic mass of nitrogen is 14. How many protons does nitrogen have? 7. So how many neutrons does it have? 14 minus 7, which equals 7. Atoms tend to be most stable when their outer electron shell is filled. This outermost electron shell that has electrons in it is called the valence electron shell. For neutral atoms, you can tell how many electrons each atom has in its valence shell by looking at its column in the periodic table. For an atom to be neutral, the amount of positive charge must equal the amount of negative charge. In other words, the number of protons must equal the number of electrons. That means that for a neutral atom, the total number of electrons must be equal to the atomic number, because the total number of electrons must equal the number of protons. The periodic table is organized so that each row corresponds to one electron shell. Hydrogen, for example, has one electron in the first electron shell. Helium has two electrons, both of which go into that first electron shell. But lithium has three electrons, and its third electron must go into the second electron shell. Both hydrogen and lithium have one valence electron. Hydrogen's valence electron is in the first electron shell, and lithium's valence electron is in the second electron shell. If we ignore the atoms in the middle of the periodic table, from scandium to zinc and the ones below it, you can see that all the atoms in the far left column have one valence electron, all the atoms in the second column have two valence electrons, all the atoms in this third column have three valence electrons, and so on. So how many valence electrons does oxygen have? 6. How about iodine? 7. These numbers at the top of the periodic table correspond to the number of valence electrons for atoms in that column. As you move to the next row, like from neon down to sodium, you're looking at a new valence shell. Neon has a full valence electron shell, the second electron shell, and sodium, which has one more electron than neon, has that next electron added to a new shell. Atoms also differ in their ability to attract more electrons. This ability is called electronegativity. Think about it as the ability of an atom, which has a set number of protons, neutrons, and electrons, to attract an outside electron and bring it into an electron shell. An atom is highly electronegative when it really attracts electrons to itself. In general, electronegativity increases as you move up and to the right along the periodic table, ignoring the far right column. Here's why. As you move to the right across a row, like from lithium over to fluorine, the distance from the nucleus to that outside electron is the same, because the atoms of the same row have the same number of electron shells. But as you move right, the atoms have more protons in their nucleus, more positive charge, so there's a greater attractive force for those negatively charged electrons. This is just like how bigger magnets have a greater attractive force. So there's greater electronegativity for fluorine than for lithium. Now think about as you move down a column on the periodic table, like from beryllium down to calcium. Every time you move down, you're at the next electron shell, which is further from the nucleus. So there's a greater distance from the nucleus to where that outer electron will come into the valence electron shell. This means there's less attractive force. It's like when you hold magnets really far apart, you don't feel a lot of attractive force, and thus lower electronegativity for calcium than for beryllium. So there are two factors, the number of protons in the nucleus and the distance from the nucleus to that extra electron. Put these two factors together and you see that the highest electronegativity tends to be in the upper right corner of the periodic table. Fluorine is very electronegative, while cesium is not. We'll see some implications of electronegativity in the next tutorial. Notice that magnets are a great analogy for atoms because positive and negative charges, protons and electrons, attract each other in a way that's very similar to how two opposite ends of a magnet attract each other. We'll use this analogy throughout these tutorials.